Hello, my name is Anthony Hall and this is a basic tutorial on how to use the matte perspective and shadow catcher tools in Lightwave 2019. So when I'm using the shadow catcher and matte perspective, I'm using it because I want to composite a 3D object into a 2D image. So what I've done is I've got a few 2D images and we're going to go through loading them up as a backdrop. So to do this in layout, you need to go to the render tab, go down to set background image, and you get this little option, and load new image. So I'm going to click load, I'm going to go to my images, and I'm going to choose one of the images I've collected. Now underneath it, there's two options that's both ticked: match perspective frame size to image and set background image option. So leave these ticks because what it'll do is it'll change your camera to the same pixel size as your and dimensions as your image, and it'll also set your background through image options for you, so you don't have to do it. Okay, so this is what we get, and if we look at the top view, we've got that match perspective. So what I'm aiming for is to get my grid flowing through the actual ground plane of this image so I can place objects on it. So under the same tab, there's an option that says match perspective. So if you click it and you get these little handles and press N on your keyboard for numerical, and it also brings numerical size up. So things that I'm going to do is I'm going to click on origins and then put on floor, and this is what we kind of get in for the time being and stuff. So the first thing what I want to do is these actual handles. So you've got green, red and blue. They refer to the X, Y and Z coordinates. So what we're going to do is use them by moving and rotating them about. What I'm going to do is put them into position so they're actually running through the different X, Y and Z positions. So when you do this, it moves the grid into that place as well, or as rough as it can be. So based on the kind of image you've got is how easy or hard this will be. If you've got buildings and roads and lots of structures that you can put these up to, it's a lot easier where this one's just got an horizon line and a tree. So the first thing what I'm going to do is I'm going to move my actual blue handles, and I'm going to place them so they're going towards the horizon like so. Do the same with the other one. Like that. I'm going to bring my red handle down, roughly bend it, and then I'm going to bring up in the air the main horizon line here with the origin on the ground. When you actually putting 3D objects into images and stuff, it's always good if you make your objects to real scale. So I'm going to put a car in this scene, but the car itself is being made to the real size it would be. So it helps to put it in your scene. It also helps to add depth of field and positioning and stuff. So as you can see, I've got roughly the actual grid has been rotated and moved. So it's actually going through or roughly across where the actual, just move it down a bit, like so. So I'm moving the origin and the guide. So what I'm trying to do is line up my grid as best I can so it looks like it's running through the road and going off into the horizon line, like so. It's a bit hit and miss at first. You've also got in the middle of these options, I mean, I've got nothing to really put the Y angle on, but you can double click at any time to lock them in place so you don't accidentally mess about with them. So once you're happy, you can lock them and lock the coordinates, but I'm happy with that for the time being. So I'm just going to say that's what I'm going to go with. So I'm going to shut the little window down and press spacebar to get rid of it. Next, what I want to do is I want to put a ground plane on here. So I've actually got a ground plane already created. So I'm going to go load an object layer. And I've got various options. So I've got a car one. And I've got two layers, a car layer and the ground layer. So I want to load the ground layer first. Now, when I load it in, what Lightwave does is it changes your grid size based on the size of whatever object you're putting in. So I always go to view, grid size, and I just put 1 meter back in the actual coordinates, so you get your ground plane running across your ground and your. So if I put a VPR on, what we've got is this, which is not what I want really, but the actual ground plane is where I want it to be. So what I need to do is I need to go into my surface editor, and on the ground plane layer at the top here it says shading models. I don't want it to be photorealistic, I want it to be a shadow catcher. So basically what it does, it removes it, but what it's there is, what it does is Lightwave knows that if objects are added and lights are shining on it, it knows where to, it uses the ground plane to catch the shadows basically. So I'm going to leave this as it is. I want my shadows just to be black, normal black and stuff. So we'll come out of that. Okay. Okay, so next what I want to do is I want to bring the actual car into my scene. So I'm going to go load an object layer. I mean, if you've just got a car on its own, you've just got to load layer, but because I've got two separate layers, I'm just doing it this way to show you. So bring the car layer in. It's going to come in quite big. Okay, well, fairly big. So here we are. It's a car. It's coming. So at this stage, what I'm going to do is let's move it back. I'll also, I mean, if you look at the size of the actual environment and the size of the car, it's probably too big based on the size of the image. So if I go to size, let's size it down a little bit. Also, let's let me rotate it so it looks as if it's kind of parked on the road as such. Now you can see straight away it's catching the shadows. Bring it forward across a bit. Say something like that. So at this stage what you need to do is you need to have a look at the size of the car to the size of the trees and adjust it accordingly to the size that you feel looks about right. So I'm gonna go with that for the time being. Again, once I've got the size, if you want to move it forward, I'll move it about. You can. I'm going to place it around there, which is quite nice. The only light in the scene is a distant light. So what I'm going to do, it says angle here, I'm going to place, say, 25%. So rather than a complete harsh shadow, it's going to make it a lot kind of feathered or subtler. So this bit here where it says angle and stuff, this is where the old dome light from 2015 has kind of been blended in with or merged in with the distant light. So this is where you're kind of getting a cross between distant and dome, which is really nice. And again, and the samples, it's up to you how high you want to go. Usually I put them up to 8, 12. I'll leave them where they are for the time being. I'm going to leave the strength where it is. Now, based on the actual color of the sky and stuff, I mean, it's white, but I can make a subtler, a very subtle kind of creamy white colour. So again, I'm going to leave that like it is. Now, looking at the shadows, it's hard to tell which way they're kind of going, but you can rotate the light if you wish. So if you go to rotate, and this will rotate the shadow to where you feel it will be. So I can see the shadows and it's dark on this side of the tree as such. So I'm wondering if the light source is somewhere behind the trees, so the shadow will be here, look like so, which I quite like. So I'm going to leave it like that, like so. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go to my backdrop options. I'm going to add a textured environment, double click the settings and then go to texture. Now I'm going to make the actual background image, I'm going to pretend it's a HDRI. I haven't got a HDRI for this, but the reason I'm doing it is because then it will use the colours out of the background and it will also use it to help reflect around the car. So I use that as a spherical, use the form and then through the Y. So now it's trying to use that image wrapped around. You don't actually see it, and it's also trying to use the reflections of it and the colour of it to help as well, which again is looking quite nice as well. So yes, it isn't a HDR image, but I'm using it for this because I'm not going to actually see it in my scene, but it'll take some of the colors and information out of the image to help light and reflect on there, like so. So now what I've got is my car in the scene ready to do a render. So if I go to my camera, I just set my camera settings up. So I'm going to put, let's say, 4 by, let's say, 12. We don't need anything too high. We're going to reduce the threshold down to 0.8. The image size, it's like 4K, is way too big. So with constraints on, I'm just going to put 1,000 in. Like so. So now it's kind of a lot. It is a lot smaller, but, I mean, it's up to you. It's 1,200. Long as constraints is on, you get the actual same dimensions and stuff. So that's the camera setup. We'll go to the render tab, render properties, start off in the render here. I'm just going to reduce all this, so the rate, all the options here are default size. I'm just going to put them all to 3, including the bounce. These are just settings I use for when I'm also putting the reflection and refraction up. These are settings I just generally use for test renders to make it quite quicker than it is. And at the bottom, if you want, where it says polygon interactive mode, if you put it on faster, that will speed it up as well. But again, obviously you use a bit of the quality, but for test renders, I always usually do something like this for it to be quicker. Global illumination, leave everything the same, except for I'm going to put rays at 12 rather than just 1. And last thing what I'm going to do is I'm going to set up a depth of field. So everything's not in focus. I want it to, the background to blur out slightly. So to do this, I'm going to go to item tab, create a null. I'll call it range. Press OK. And then you can see it here. And then I'm going to move it along and move it back. So as I'm moving it back, there is numbers around it. So that's the position away from the actual center of your grid, which I'm not bothered about that. I want my actual range to be from a null to the actual camera. So why the actual null is here, and I've got it selected, I go to properties, appearance, from the drop down go down to rangefinder, double click it and click draw link to camera, so it shows you, and it also shows you that it's 9.6 meters away. So let's set that up as a buffer. So we go to render properties, buffer, select the depth, put adaptive sampling on here, and where it says far, I'm going to put 9.6 meters. Then we go to output and make sure that it's also ticked in there, so we're also rendering both out as so. So now I'm ready to do a render of it. Okay, so click render. Okay, so that's just rendered for me. So it's took 43.6 seconds, which it isn't too bad. I mean, I'm using a Intel i7-7700K, 32 gig of RAM. And like I said, I've showed you the settings I'm using, so press continue. And what we've got here, yeah, there's a few fireflies, and the quality could be a lot better, but I've reduced the settings to do a quick render because I just want to use it as a kind of draft to show you how quickly you can do this. And so next what I'll do is I'm going to save this, just save it as a JPEG. I'll save it in here as a car new one. I don't know what it is. And then with the buffers, I'll go to the depth. Now the depth isn't previewing quite right, so I'm not sure why, but it will work. So file, save as a JPEG, and we'll call it car new D1, so I know what they are, and save that. Okay, so we'll open up Photoshop. We'll open up those two renders, which is car new D1 and car new. There we go. So what I want to do is, here's a depth map. I want to put that into my alpha channel to make it so I can use this depth field. So using the select tool, I'm going to select the whole image I'm going to copy it. I'm going to go into my original car render, go to the channels, add a new channel, and then Command V to paste it in. Turn all the other channels back on, but turn the alpha back off. We can shut that down then. And then if we go back to our original layer here, we go to Filter, Blur, Lens Blur. It will choose the alpha for you. And now you can see there's a slight depth of field. So wherever I click in Photoshop, it will add the focus point. Then it's up to you how much you want the actual background to be blurred out, like so. So if you want it quite shallow. I mean, the only problem is with not getting your depth of field quite right. That looks more like a toy because it looks quite small. So, and I don't want it that much out anyway. But yeah, I'm looking around there with a very slight depth of field. Press OK. The only other thing you can do if you want is sometimes I go into image, and a lot of people don't use this, is the auto tone, contrast and colour, and just literally click each one. And then, I mean, the last one's made it slightly purpley, so we go to edit, fade colour, and just bring it down a bit, like so. And there you have it. So that's the outcome from using Shadow Catcher and match perspective and adding a little depth of field. So hopefully it's been easy enough to follow, and thanks for listening.